Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Age of Opportunity, A Biblical Guide to Parenting Teens, by Paul David Tripp. Narrated by William Sarris. Publisher's Note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Preface. It was in August of 1971 that I took my first pastoral position as the youth director of Whaley Street United Methodist Church in Columbia, South Carolina. I was 3 months away from my 21st birthday. Those days at Whaley Street seem so distant, almost like part of someone else's life. Yet there is one thing that remains with me, a desire to see the gospel applied to those difficult years when a person passes from childhood into adulthood. I couldn't have written this book in 1971. In many ways, I was one of the youth that I am writing about here. But more than that, there was much work that God needed to do in me through many people that He would raise up. It would be impossible to list all the people who have contributed to the thinking that is reflected here. This book represents the loving ministry of pastors, teachers, friends, fellow elders, and family, all who have contributed to my understanding of what it means to live biblically. My prayer is that this book would give hope, courage, and insight to thousands of parents who are entering or are in the midst of the teen years with their children. May the truths of God's Word turn a time of anxious survival into a time of expectation and opportunity. Part 1. Clearing the Debris. Chapter 1. Age of Opportunity, or Season for Survival. It is everywhere around us, on the television sitcom, in the magazine on the supermarket rack, on the shelves of the local bookstore, on television and radio talk shows, and yes, even in a number of Christian books on the family. Parents are afraid of their teenagers. Even as they are enjoying the early years of a child's life, they are looking over their shoulders with dread, expecting the worst, knowing that in a few short years this precious little one will turn into a monster overnight. They've heard enough stories from parents who have gone through the dark valley of the teen years to know the dangers that lie ahead. They are told to expect the worst and to be thankful if they come out of the valley sane, with their teenager alive and their family intact. I encountered this view of the teen years recently at a marriage conference. It had been a great weekend in all ways. The teaching had been engaging, convicting, and encouraging. The food and accommodations had been superb, and the conference had been held in a beautiful seaside location. Near the end of the weekend, I was looking out at the sun glistening on the waters of the bay when I noticed a couple sitting nearby. They looked very unhappy. I was curious, so I asked them if they had enjoyed the weekend. "Everything had been great," they replied. I commented that they didn't look very happy. The woman responded, "We have two teenagers, and we are dreading going home. We wish this weekend would last forever."
"You just have to expect your teenager to be rebellious. All of us were," her husband added. "You just have to ride it out."
"Besides," she moaned, "you can't argue with hormones." I walked away impressed that something is fundamentally wrong with the way we think about this time in a child's life. Something is inherently wrong with the cultural epidemic of fear and cynicism about our teenagers. Something is wrong when a parent's highest goal is survival. We need to take another look. Is this a biblical view of this period in a child's life? Does this view lead to biblical strategies of parenting and biblical hope? We need to examine what is wrong with the cynicism about teenagers that is endemic in our culture. A biological view of teens. We often talk about our teenagers as if they were nothing more than collections of raging rebel hormones encased in developing skin. We see our goal as somehow holding these hormones back so that we can survive until the teen has reached 20. A parent recently rejoiced to me that her son had turned 20
as if he had passed through some magic portal from danger into safety. "We made it," she said. This survival mentality exposes the poverty of this view of teenagers. Many parents who talk to me about their teenagers talk without hope. They see them as victims of hormones that drive them to do crazy things. Although they would never say this, the working theology that hides behind this view is that the truths of Scripture, the power of the gospel, biblical communication, and godly relationship are no match for the teen years. Yes, we believe that God's word is powerful and effective, except if some poor soul is trying to apply it to a child between the years of 13 and 19. We now even have a category of children called preteen. These are the years when the monsterish characteristics of the teenagers begin to develop and rear their ugly heads. Are we comfortable with a view of teenagers that says that because of the significant biological changes going on inside them, they are essentially unreachable? Are we comfortable with a hormonal view of teens that reduces them to victims of biological forces, freeing them from responsibility for their own choices and actions? Do we really want a view of teens that would have us believe that the truths that give life and hope to anyone who believes cannot reach a teenager? We cannot hold on to a robust belief in the power of the gospel if we continue to buy into our culture's cynicism about the teen years. Particular sacrifice and suffering? In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22, Paul exhorts Timothy to flee the evil desires, lusts, of youth. This interesting little phrase calls us to be balanced in the way we think about teenagers and the way we define this time of life. On the one hand, the Bible challenges us not to be naive about this period of life. There are lusts that uniquely plague young people, temptations that are particularly powerful. These must be faced. Scripture enjoins us to be strategic, to ask the question, what are the evil desires that grip a person during this phase of life? At the same time, Paul uses the qualifier youthful, because each phase of life has its own set of temptations. The temptations of the little boy, the young man, and the old man are not identical. The temptations of the teenager are not particularly savage and severe. Each person at each time in his life, if he seeks to please the Lord, must watch, pray, stand fast, and fight, lest he fall into temptation. The teenager is called to guard against the temptations that are unique to youth, while the older person is called to guard against the temptations unique to that age. Each person, whatever his or her age, must accept each stage of warfare as a Christian living in this fallen world. Battle of biology or battle of the heart. The 2 Timothy passage is also helpful in the way it locates and defines the battle of youth. There is a battle raging in the lives of young people, but it is not the battle of biology. It is an intensely spiritual battle, a battle for the heart. This is exactly what Paul wants us to be aware of as he exhorts Timothy not to let his heart be controlled by evil desires. This battle is not unique to teens. It takes a certain shape during the teen years, but it is the battle of every sinner. The tendency of every sinner, no matter what his age, is captured well by Paul in Romans chapter 1, verse 25. That is, the tendency to exchange worship and service of the Creator for the worship and service of the created thing. Yes, it's there in the life of the teenager who forsakes his convictions for the approval of his peers, but it is just as powerfully present in the adult who compromises family and spiritual priorities for professional success. The battle, as Paul understands it, is a heart battle, and it is dramatically important because what controls the heart will direct the life. There are significant temptations of the heart that greet teenagers, calling them to believe that they cannot live without some aspect of the creation. These voices call them to believe that identity, meaning, and purpose can be found in the creature rather than the creator. These are the life-altering conflicts of the teen years. We dare not miss them because of our biologically oriented fears and our survival mentality. We must believe that Jesus came so that each of us would be freed from the desires of our sinful nature, so that we may serve Him and Him alone. This includes our teenagers. The struggles of parents. The tumult of the teen years is not only about the attitudes and actions of teens, but the thoughts, desires, attitudes, and actions of parents as well. The teen years are hard for us because they tend to bring out the worst in us. It is in these years that parents hear themselves saying things that they never thought they would say. Parents find themselves reacting with accusations, guilt manipulation, and ultimatums, responding with a level of anger that they would not have thought possible. It is in these years that parents struggle with embarrassment at being related to the teen who was once, as a child, a great source of pride and joy. It is vital for us to confess that the struggle of the teen years is not only about teen biology and teen rebellion. These years are hard for us because they expose the wrong thoughts and desires of our own hearts. There is a principle here that we need to recognize. My mother put it this way: there is nothing that comes out of a drunk that was not there in the beginning. These years are hard for us because they rip back the curtain and expose us. This is why trials are so difficult, yet so useful in God's hands. We don't radically change in a moment of trial. No, trials expose what we have always been. Trials bear things to which we would have otherwise been blind. So, too, the teen years expose our self-righteousness, our impatience, our unforgiving spirit, our lack of servant love, the weakness of our faith, and our craving for comfort and ease. Why we miss the opportunities. I sat recently in my office with a father who was so angry at his son that it was all he could do to be civil. He did not see the tremendous spiritual needs in his son that he had been uniquely positioned by God to meet. There was no tenderness in their relationship. There wasn't even cordiality. There was a tense distance. At one point, the father rose to speak to his son about his report card. He walked to his son's chair and stuck the failing report card in his face and said, "How dare you do this to me after all I have done for you?" To him, the bad grades were a personal affront. This was not the way he thought it was supposed to work. He had done his job. Now the son was supposed to do his. He was angry at his son, but not because of his sin against God. He was angry because his son had taken things away from him as a father that he valued very much. His reputation as a successful Christian father, the respect he thought he deserved, and the ease he thought he would finally achieve with older children. There was no attitude of ministry, no sense of opportunity, no quest to be part of what God was doing in the life of his son. Instead, he was filled with the anger described in James chapter 4, verse 2. You want something, but you don't get it. The cultural cynicism we have been discussing is based on who we think teenagers are and what we think they are going through. We tend to believe that there is little we can do to make these years more productive. Rather, the culture would say, we need to come up with positive strategies of survival that preserve the sanity of the parents and the stability of the marriage, and that keep the teenager out of as much self-inflicted danger as possible. However, it is my experience that when parents begin to recognize, own, confess, and turn from their own wrong heart attitudes and the wrong actions that flow from them, the result is a marked difference in their relationship to their teen and in the way they view the struggles of the teen years. When we look with concerned eyes toward the teen years, we need to look not only at our children, but also at ourselves. Parents who are humbly willing to change position themselves to be God's instruments of change. A better way. It is time for us to reject the wholesale cynicism of our culture regarding adolescence. Rather than years of undirected and unproductive struggle, these are years of unprecedented opportunity. They are the golden age of parenting, when you begin to reap all the seeds you have sown in their lives, when you can help your teenager to internalize truth, preparing him or her for a productive, God-honoring life as an adult. These are the years of penetrating questions, the years of wonderful discussions never before possible. These are the years of failure and struggle that put the teen's true heart on the table. These are the years of daily ministry and of great opportunity. These are not years merely to be survived. They are to be approached with a sense of hope and a sense of mission. Almost every day brings a new opportunity to enter the life of your teen with help, hope, and truth. We should not resign ourselves to an increasingly distant relationship. This is the time to connect with our children as never before. These are years of great opportunity. That is what this book is about. It is a book of opportunity and hope. It is time for us to come out of the bunkers of cynicism and fear and into the light, examining the plan God has for us as we parent our teenagers. This is a book about activity, goals, and practical strategies. This is a book that believes that the truths of Scripture apply as powerfully to teens as they do to anyone else. At the same time, this book will not be naive. The teen years are often cataclysmic years of conflict, struggle, and grief. They are years of new temptations, of trial and testing. Yet these very struggles, conflicts, trials, and tests are what produce such wonderful parental opportunities. Recognizing God's moments of change. It was a wintry Tuesday night. I had had counseling appointments all day and had taught for 3 hours in the evening. I was driving home at about 10 o'clock, dreaming about an hour or so of relaxation before I hit the bed. I silently hoped that for some inexplicable reason, the whole family had gone to sleep at 9 o'clock. Or if they had not gone to bed, I hoped that they would instinctively know that I was tired and not to be disturbed. I reasoned that I had served God faithfully that day. Surely God would agree that I had the right to punch out from life. I dreamed of an empty family room, a well-iced Diet Coke, the newspaper, and the remote control. I was totally exhausted, and I had a right to relax. You can see that I was approaching the house with a selfless attitude of ministry. I quietly opened the door in the vain hope that I could sneak in unnoticed. The living room lights were out, and the house was quiet. I was filled with hope. Maybe my dreams had come true. An evening of relaxation all to myself. I had only put one foot in the door when I heard an angry voice. My heart sank. I wanted to act as if I hadn't heard it. It was the voice of Ethan, my teenage son. My disappointment soon gave way to anger. I wanted to grab him and say, "Don't you know what my day has been like? Don't you know how tired I am? The last thing I need right now is to deal with your problems. You're going to have to solve this one yourself. I wish for once you'd think of somebody besides yourself. I do and do for you, and this is the thanks I get? You can't leave me alone one night?" All these thoughts raged within me, but I didn't say a word. I listened to Ethan as he poured out his complaint. He was as angry as he had ever been at his older brother. He was cursing the fact that he had an older brother who seemed to do nothing but trash his life. It was after 10. The issue that started this thing was petty. I was tempted to tell him to get a grip and deal with it, but another agenda gripped me. Here was one of those unexpected moments of opportunity, one of those mundane moments ordained by a loving and sovereign God where the heart of my teenager was being exposed. It was more than an Ethan and Dad moment. This was God's moment. A dynamic moment of redemption where God was continuing the work of rescue he had begun years ago in my son. The only question in the moment was whether I would pursue God's agenda or my own. Would I believe the gospel in that moment, trusting God to give me what I needed so that I could do what he was calling me to do in the life of my son? I asked Ethan to sit down at the dining room table and tell me what was going on. He was hurt and angry. His heart was on the table. We talked through his anger, and he became ready to listen. A petty argument with his brother opened the door to discussing things that were far from petty. God gave me strength and patience. He filled my mouth with the right things to say. Ethan saw himself in new ways that night and confessed to things that he had never before recognized. It was approaching midnight when I said goodnight to Ethan. We hugged and went to bed. What first appeared to be an irritating moment over an obviously petty issue had in fact been a wonderful opportunity of ministry, ordained by a God of love. It became very clear that God wasn't only working to change Ethan, he was working to change me as well. The selfishness of my heart had been revealed that evening, the same selfishness that causes parents to lash out in anger at the very teens who need them. My need of Christ, too, had been exposed. There was no way I could function as his instrument without his strength. Little Moments, High Calling. I chose to write about this moment because it was one of those unremarkable moments that not only happen daily, but many times a day. Each of these moments is loaded with opportunity. There are many, many more of these moments than the dramatic moments of adolescence, like pregnancy, drugs, and violence, that get so much press. None of us lives constantly in the grand moments of significant decision. There aren't many of them in life. No, we live in the world of the incredibly mundane. This is where we need to see our teenagers with the eyes of opportunity rather than eyes of dread and fear. The argument over the last Pop-Tart, the cry of nothing to wear a half hour before school, the report card crumpled in the pocket of jeans headed for the wash, the pouting expression in the face of a parent's no, the third fender bender in a month, the constant words of discontent, the everybody else does, and the I'm the only one whose parents make them, all must be seen as something more than hassles that get in the way of an otherwise enjoyable life. These are the moments God made parents for. You are God's agents on the watch. You have been given an incredibly high calling. You are God's instrument of help and preparation as this child makes his final steps out of the home and into God's world. These moments make your life worthwhile. Here, you will make a contribution that is worth infinitely more than any career or financial accomplishment. Recognizing the opportunities. The more I have lived with my own teenage children, watched their peers, and interacted with other parents of teenagers, the more I am convinced that this is a time of unbridled opportunity. There are issues that get exposed in this delicate, scary, awkward, and volatile period of development that make it so full of opportunity. It is not a time to head for the bunkers. It is not a time to dread worst-case scenarios of total domestic chaos. This is not a time to accept a culturally dictated generation gap. This is a time to jump into the battle and move toward your teenager. It is a time for engagement, interaction, discussion, and committed relationship. This is not a time to let a teenager hide his doubts, fears, and failures, but a time to pursue, love, encourage, teach, forgive, confess, and accept. It is a wonderful time. As I write this, my wife and I have three teenagers. We have never had more of a sense of calling. We have laughed, cried, discussed, and prayed with our teens. We have struggled for them and with them. We have seen failure and trial as opportunity. We have not always responded in faith, and we have needed to confess our own sin, but we have committed to one another that this is a wonderful period of family life. We are so happy to be doing what we are doing. We see the glory of God being revealed even in the midst of our own feeble efforts and weak faith. There are three fundamental doors of opportunity that every teenage parent can walk through. Each of these problems becomes a means of helping the teenager to internalize the truths to which he has been exposed for years. The problems of teenage insecurity, teenage rebellion, and the teenager's widening world are actually God's doors of opportunity, where parents have unique access to the central issues in their teenagers' lives. T. teenage insecurity. Teenagers are not secure people. The teenager who seems secure at breakfast can easily fall apart by supper. The teenager who goes to bed thinking she looks okay awakes, looks in the mirror before breakfast, and becomes convinced that her head is too large for her body. The teenager who is secure because he thinks he finally understands enough of the rules to be thought of as a quasi-normal humanoid will be convinced he is a terminal social misfit because of an embarrassing moment at a party. Our son Ethan was about 15 when he came in one afternoon, obviously discouraged. I asked him what was wrong. He told me that every day, people made fun of him on the way to or from school. He said, "I see them looking at me and talking and laughing." It was a tough period for him. He was rapidly growing. He was unsure of himself, his body, and his looks. He was in that limbo land between boy and man, and he projected his insecurity to everyone around him. This time of physical insecurity provided many opportunities for listening, love, encouragement, and the gospel. This is a period when the teenager is flooded with questions. Who am I? Do I look okay? Why is life so confusing? Will I ever remember all of the rules? What is right and what is wrong? Who is right and who is wrong? What is happening to my body? What am I going to do with my life? Will I be a success or a failure? Do people really like me? Am I normal? Is my family normal? Is God for real? The world of physical appearance, the world of relationships, the world of ideas, the world of responsibilities, and the world of the future are all scary and uncertain to the teenager. It is this reality that makes this time such an age of opportunity. In the midst of these questions, significant biblical themes can be discussed, such as the doctrine of creation, the fear of man, the sovereignty of God, the nature of truth, identity in Christ, and spiritual warfare and temptation, to mention a few. In the context of daily insecurities, we have an opportunity to help the teen make conceptual theology become functional, life-shaping theology. Each of these questions provides an opportunity to discuss, test, experience, apply, and internalize important biblical truths. Teenage rebellion. The stories of gross and flagrant rebellion are one of the reasons that parents fear the teen years. The thought that the once precious child will turn into the leader of the violent neighborhood gang is the parent's worst nightmare. We have to reevaluate our expectation of automatic teen rebellion. At the same time, we have to recognize that this is an age when children push at the boundaries, when temptation abounds, and when peer relationships do not always encourage right behavior. We received one of those dreaded calls one Sunday afternoon. It was a mother in our church telling us that our son had not stayed at her house overnight as we had thought. She told us that our son had asked her son to cover for him, but he was conscience-stricken and went to his mother for help. She called us. We were afraid and disappointed. For a moment, we gave in to worst-case scenarios. How many more lies had there been? Were we living with a son we did not know? At the same time, we were so deeply thankful for the Lord's rescuing mercy. We questioned our son, and he confessed. It was a watershed moment of choosing whom he would serve. We left the room so thankful that an event we had hoped would never happen had, in God's plan of mercy, taken place. There are desires that make the teenager susceptible to the temptation to rebel, the desire to be an individual and think for oneself, the desire for freedom, the desire to try new things, the desire to test the boundaries, the desire for control, the desire to make one's own decisions, the desire to be different, the desire to fit in, and the desire to be accepted. These, with a host of other desires, all fueled by the autonomy and self-centeredness of the sin nature, can surely lead the teenager astray. At the same time, these struggles of rebellion and submission become the context in which another set of critical biblical issues can be discussed, applied, and internalized. Biblical truths having to do with authority, sowing and reaping, the nature of truth and falsehood, wisdom and foolishness, law and grace, confession, repentance, forgiveness, and the nature and function of the heart, all get put on the table in the midst of these crucial moments of submission and rebellion. Parents, with eyes toward opportunity, will have many, many openings to deal with central issues of biblical faith in the life of their teenager. A teenager's widening world. One of the frightening things for parents, and a source of insecurity for their teenagers, is the sudden explosion of the teen's world. All of a sudden, it seems as if the world gets bigger. That little boy or girl who played for hours on the backyard swing set now drives miles away to new locations, new experiences, and new friends. This world is not always exciting to the teenager. Sometimes it seems scary and overwhelming. There are moments when the teen is alive with the joy of discovery, and there are other times when he is shy and avoiding. Sometimes he enjoys being a teenager, while at other times he seems afraid of the new expectations laid upon him. There is no stopping the widening of his world. It is a world of new friends, new locations, new opportunities and responsibilities, new thoughts, new plans, new freedoms, new temptations, new feelings, new experiences, and new discoveries. All of the joys and insecurities of this widening world provide opportunities to help your teenager really understand and personally internalize fundamental truths. These include the sovereignty and providence of God, the ever-present help of the Lord, the nature of biblical relationships, spiritual warfare, discipline, self-control, contentment, faithfulness, trustworthiness, the nature of the body of Christ, the world, the flesh, and the devil, the principles of responsibility and accountability, biblical priorities, discovery and stewardship of gifts, and many other biblical truths and principles. That's quite a list. But this widening world provides wonderful opportunities for parents to prepare their teenager for an effective and productive life in God's world. Rejecting the cynicism. The place to begin as we build a biblical understanding of parenting our teenagers is to reject the dark, foreboding cynicism of our culture. Yes, the teen years are years of change, insecurity, and tumult, yet these are the very things that God uses to bring truth to light in the eyes of our children. If we are to be His instruments, we must deal with our own idolatry and bring a robust biblical faith to each rocky moment, a faith that believes that God rules over all things for our sake, that He is an ever-present help in trouble, that He is at work in every situation accomplishing His redemptive purpose, and that His word is powerful, active, and effective. We do not want to be driven into bunkers of survival by teenage insecurity, rebellion, and widening world. Rather, we want to take Paul's call to Timothy as God's agenda for our work with our teens. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season, correct, rebuke, and encourage, with great patience and careful instruction. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2. We want to approach these important years with hope, not hope in our teenagers or hope in ourselves, but hope in God, who is able to do more than anything we could ever ask or imagine as we seize the opportunities He places in our path. We want to approach these years with a sense of purpose and a sense of calling. When people ask you what you do, say, "I am the parent of a teenager. It is the most important job I have ever had. Everything else I do for a living is secondary." Then say, "You know, I have never had a job that is so exciting. I have never had a job that is so full of opportunities. Every day I am needed. Every day I do things that are important, worthwhile, and lasting. I wouldn't give up this job for anything." Chapter 2. Whose idols are in the way? If we are ever to be effective for Christ in the lives of our teenagers, it is important to be honest about our own idols, the places where we have tended to exchange worship and service of the Creator for worship and service of created things. Too often, when we seek to understand the struggles of adolescence, we only look at teenagers and their problems. In reality, it is time for us to take a look inside and ask, what really rules our hearts? Now, surely, every Christian parent would spontaneously give the correct theological answer. We are God's children. He rules our hearts. Or does He? This is not about a theological affirmation, but about our day-to-day worship. At the level where the rubber meets the road, in the bedrooms, living rooms, kitchens, and hallways of life, what really controls our hearts? Start with your heart. It is a waste of time for us as parents to think about strategies for parenting our teens without first examining ourselves. If our hearts are controlled by something other than God, we will not view the golden parenting opportunities of the teen years as opportunities at all. Instead, they will be a constant stream of irritating hassles brought on by an incredibly self-centered person who is neither adult nor child, but who has the uncanny ability to make even the most unimportant moments of our lives chaotic. The cynicism of our culture toward teenagers not only reveals something about who teenagers are, but it also reveals what we as parents are serving. Our hearts blind us to the opportunities all around us during the teen years. There is an important principle here that is taught all through Scripture, but enunciated most clearly in Ezekiel chapter 14, verse 4. This is what the Sovereign Lord says: when any Israelite sets up idols in his heart and puts a wicked stumbling block before his face and then goes to a prophet, I, the Lord, will answer him in keeping with his great idolatry. Let me put this passage in my own words. The leaders of Israel have come to God to hear His words to them, but as they come, God recognizes that their hearts have been captured by idols. So God says, because there are idols in your hearts, the only thing that I am interested in talking about is your idolatry. Why? There is a little phrase here that clues us in. God says that when a person sets up an idol in his heart, he also puts a wicked stumbling block before his face. The principle revealed here is the principle of inescapable influence. What controls my heart will control my life. An idol of the heart will always put a wicked stumbling block before my face. Imagine that you have placed your hand, with fingers narrowly separated, in front of your face. When you attempt to look through your fingers, your vision is obstructed. As long as your hand is in front of your face, no matter where you turn to look, your vision will be altered by your fingers. So it is with an idol in my heart. It will exercise inescapable influence over my life. Wherever I go, whatever I am doing, the idol will influence what I do and how I do it. This is the reason God says, it makes no sense for me to talk about anything else, because whatever I say, somehow, some way, will be used to serve the idol that rules your heart. Therefore, I want to deal with your idolatry. That is my priority. We cannot ignore this central issue. I am deeply persuaded that our idols have caused us to see opportunity as trial, and caused us to strike back at our teenagers with bitter words of judgment, accusation, and condemnation, behaving toward them with intolerance and anger. While God is calling us to love, accept, forgive, and serve, we are often barely able to be nice. Let's consider some typical parental idols and the way they shape our responses to our teens. The idol of comfort. Secretly in our hearts, many of us want life to be a resort. A resort is a place where you are the one who is served. Your needs come first, and you only do what you want to do when you want to do it. The only demands you deal with in a resort are the demands you put on yourself. At a resort, you live with a sense of entitlement. You've paid your money, and you have the right to expect certain things. I am afraid that many of us live for comfort and bring this entitlement mentality to our parenting. We reason that we have the right to quiet, harmony, peace, and respect, and we respond in anger when we do not get it. Scripture warns us that life is far from being a resort. Life is war. This is clearly demonstrated in the teen years. I have said to my teenagers many times as they are leaving home, "There is a war out there. It is being fought on the turf of your heart. It is being fought for the control of your soul." The tumult, chaos, and unrest of the teen years are not only the result of significant biological changes taking place, but because of a dramatic spiritual war going on as well. Parents who demand comfort, ease, regularity, peace, space, quiet, and harmony will be ill-equipped for this war. They will begin to see their teenager as the enemy. They will begin to fight with him rather than for him. And even worse, they will tend to forget the true nature of the battle and the identity of the real enemy. They will act out of frustrated desire, doing and saying regrettable things, and they will fail to be effective and productive in those strategic moments of ministry in which God has placed them. The idol of respect. The father had stomped on every one of his daughter's CDs. He had locked her in her room every night and had publicly shared her sins with the whole church at a prayer meeting. He had slapped her in the face in front of her friends and tried to goad and belittle her into submission. He never failed to remind her that he had been a model teen. In my office, he told me with great energy and resolve, "I will get her to respect me if it is the last thing I ever do." Respect is what ruled his heart. He was convinced that he was entitled to it. Thus, every issue became an issue of respect. He saw disrespect where there was none. Life became a series of final exams in which he never gave his daughter better than an F. He viewed all of the development, insecurity, and awkwardness of his daughter as a personal affront. There was no vertical, spiritual dimension to his thinking. He saw his daughter not in terms of her relationship to God, but only in relation to himself. He did not see himself as an agent to lead her to a life-saving fear of God. His heart was driven by the goal that she would fear him and give him the respect he thought he deserved. Is respect a good thing? Of course. Is it something that parents should seek to instill in their children? Yes. But it must not be the thing that controls my heart, or I will personalize what is not personal. I will lose sight of my role as God's representative, and I will fight for and demand what only God can produce. Sadly, the father's eyes were blind to the God that ruled him, and to the fact that in his quest to get respect, he encouraged the exact opposite response. The idol of appreciation. We've been there when the calls have come from school. We've been there in the wee hours of the morning when the nightmares have hit. We've changed the bed that had been wet once again. We've gone out in pajamas and slippers to the all-night drugstore for medicine. We've made the special skateboard-shaped birthday cakes. We've cleaned up vomit from the bedroom carpet. We've sat in on meetings with the principal. We've spent hours making the papier-mâché volcano. We've provided transportation to thousands of events. We've sat through scores of painful recitals, spent thousands on memorable vacations. We've walked miles and miles in the aisles of the supermarket so mouths could be fed and stomachs filled. We've trudged hours through malls looking for cool clothes. We've washed enough clothes to fill the Grand Canyon. We've given up our dreams to pay for musical instruments and braces. Isn't it about time we get some credit? I cannot tell you how many times I've heard parts of this list recited to me by parents, always with that same final punchline. It seems so logical, so harmless, so right. Children should appreciate their parents. Yet being appreciated cannot be our goal. When it becomes the thing we live for, we will unwittingly look with hypervigilant eyes for appreciation in every situation. Teenagers don't often burst in the door at the end of the day and say, "Do you know what I was thinking about on the bus ride home today, Mom? I was thinking about how much you and Dad have done for me over the years. You have been with me and for me from the very first moment of my life until now. On the bus, I was flooded with gratitude, and I just couldn't wait to get home and say thank you." If this happens to you, erect stones as a lasting memorial or light an eternal flame. Very few parents have headed to bed only to hear sobbing coming from their teenage daughter's bedroom and had this conversation. "What's wrong, dear?" "Oh, I was just thinking about you and Mom and how unthankful I've been. I feel so guilty that I haven't appreciated you more, and I've committed myself to demonstrating that I appreciate you every day." On the contrary, the trend for teenagers is to be much more filled with self-orientation and self-interest than to be filled with an awareness and appreciation of others. If parents have forgotten their own vertical relationship with God as they've ministered to their teens, if they think of it all as an "I serve, you appreciate" contract between parent and child, they will struggle with lots of discouragement and anger during the teen years. Just when parents expect their almost grown child to give a little something back, they seem to be more selfish and lacking in gratitude than ever before. Again, every parent needs to ask, "Why am I doing what I am doing? Who am I serving? What are the things that I have come to expect and demand? Whose desires rule the moments of opportunity with my teenager, God's or mine?" The idol of success. I listened as the father said to me in the presence of his teenage son, "Do you know what it's like to go to church and know that everyone there has been talking about and praying for your rebellious son? Do you know what it's like to enter a service with all eyes on you, knowing that people are wondering how it is going and how you and your wife are coping? This is not the way it is supposed to be. We tried to faithfully do everything God called us to do as parents, and look what we ended up with. I ask myself, if I knew that this was the way it would all turn out, would we have ever chosen to have children? I cannot describe how disappointed and embarrassed I am." That afternoon, with his son listening, that father spoke what many parents have felt but never verbalized. We tend to approach parenting with expectations as if we had hard and fast guarantees. We think that if we do our part, our children will be model citizens. Yet, in a fallen world, this is not the way it works. We tend to approach parenting with a sense of ownership, that these are our children, and their obedience is our right. These assumptions pave the way for our identity to get wrapped up in our children. We begin to need them to be what they should be so that we can feel a sense of achievement and success. We begin to look at our children as our trophies rather than God's creatures. We secretly want to display them on the mantles of our lives as visible testimonies to a job well done. When they fail to live up to our expectations, we find ourselves not grieving for them and fighting for them, but angry at them, fighting against them, and, in fact, grieving for ourselves and our loss. We are angry because they have taken something valuable away from us, something we have come to treasure, something that has come to rule our hearts, a reputation for success. It is so easy to lose sight of the fact that these are God's children. They do not belong to us. They are given not to bring us glory, but Him. Our teenagers are from Him. They exist through Him, and the glory of their lives points to Him. We are but agents to accomplish His plan. We are but instruments in His hands. Our identity is rooted in Him and His call to us, not in our children and their performance. The ultimate rejection that should make us weep is not that they have rejected us, but Him. As parents, we are in trouble whenever we lose sight of these vertical realities, when we lose sight of God.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.